Did you know that the first computer can be traced all the way back to Adam and Eve? They were the first ones to ever use a computer. It was an Apple. And just like all Apples, all Apple devices, it has limited memory. And just one byte, then everything crashes. Killer tech on this biblical episode of Attack of the Killer Podcast. Hail Satan.
Attention, planet Earth and beyond. Stay tuned for Attack of the Killer Podcast. Attack of the Killer Podcast. Attack of the Killer Podcast. Attack of the Killer Podcast.
Hello and welcome to another episode of Attack of the Killer Podcast. I am your host, Insane Mike, and this is episode 280. We will be talking about killer tech. In this day and age of advanced technology, such as car phones, Walkmans, and video cassette recorders, we are truly living in the future. But the future can be scary, and the films we have lined up for this episode pack a megabyte.
Oh, Jesus.
Attack of the Killer Podcast is a horror movie podcast where a group of friends get together with a topic and we discuss films within that topic. Now, we're all just friends hanging out, talking horror movies, so there may be spoilers. You've been warned. If this is your first time listening to Attack of the Killer Podcast and you're already hooked, you should become a supporter of the show. You can help keep the show alive by going to jointheattackers.com and donate to the show. When you do support us, you become part of the Attack of the Killer Podcast family. We call those people the attackers. Being an attacker, you get all kinds of cool stuff. You can get your very own membership card, certificate, and sticker. There are bonus episodes, videos, early access to the main show, shout-outs on the show, invites to our monthly horror hangout and watch parties, and even you get an invite to the exclusive chat called Attack of the Killer Chat. You can also get like shirt or even original art by me, Insane Mike, called Mikey's Monsters, where I draw you as a monster of my choice. You can get all that sweet bonus content, and all you have to do is go to jointheattackers.com.
Like they forgot who was talking to them. Okay.
They might. That was good. They might. That was if it's their first time listening,
it's true.
They don't know. Right. And now it is time to introduce you to the podcast crew. He got fired from his job at the keyboard factory because he was not doing enough shifts. Jason.
Hey, everybody. It's puns now that this guy. Thanks for tuning in. We really appreciate you being here.
His iPhone stopped working. Hey, this is no joke. It's dead serious. Tad.
My iPhone works just fine. Hi, guys.
His phone wears glasses because it lost its contacts. Andy!
Yeah. That joke was so bad, it stunk. It was
last but not least, our first special guest from the Bret and Tony podcast with Ash and Abe, and a graduate from the National University of Science and Technology. Ah, yes, good old NUST. It's not called National University of Technology and Science. That would be nuts. Bret Royer, everybody!
Hey, guys. Excited.
And we are excited to have you here.
Yeah.
Shudder.
Yeah.
It's an amazing streaming service that all horror fans should have. From classic horror to foreign films and even Shudder originals. There is something for every type of horror fan. If you have not subscribed yet to Shudder, you should start by getting a month of Shudder for free thanks to us here at Attack of the Killer Podcast. Enter our promo code AOTKP and you get a month of Shudder absolutely for free.
Free?
Free. Again, that promo code is AOTKP. And speaking of P, that's what I'm going to do while Tad takes over with what we watched.
What we watched.
It's been a pretty strong start for horror in this year. And I'm not sure, is he actually peeing, Jason?
No.
Mike. Still sitting here. Mike, what have you watched?
Okay, well, I have quite the diverse selection of things that I've watched this time. I'm going to start off by saying I watched Teen Titans Go and the DC Supergirls Mayhem into the Multiverse.
Easy for you to say.
So
how was it?
Okay, so like the Teen Titans Go cartoon show.
You said.
The Teen Titans Go cartoon show is kind of like it's funny for 30 seconds and then, but I've really enjoyed the movies.
So right up your alley.
When they did Teen Titans Ghost in the movies, that's when Simon was still into Teen Titans Go. So that was a few years back, and it was really way better than it should have been. So then they did a direct-to-DVD movie of Teen Titans Go versus Teen Titans. So it was like the two different Teen Titans cartoons joining forces.
Teen Titans being way superior.
Oh, so definitely, amazing. definitely.
Double Teen Titans.
Teen Titans Go is just a
over the
parody
top, super
of
doofy.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. And that was actually really awesome too. It was funny. It was smart and had a lot of cool, things of connective multiverse things. So when I saw this on HBO Max, Teen Titans Go and the DC Supergirls Mayhem into the Multiverse, I'm like, oh, cool, more multiverse stuff, crossing cartoons, whatever, this will be fun. It sucked.
All over.
It was bad because they knew what they were doing. It was clearly Teen Titans Go is a popular property that they literally just slapped it onto this less popular property, the DC Supergirls, just so that people would watch. I mean, they suckered me into it because Teen Titans Go shows up throughout the movie, but only in narration of what's going on. They're like sitting watching the storyline of the DC Supergirls. And there's one scene right in the middle where they cross over the characters for like one tiny scene, and that's it. It is so blatantly a cash grab that they even call it out in the show. The Teen Titans Go characters talk about how this movie is not. They literally are talking about how this movie was nothing more than a cash grab, taking the Teen Titans Go popularity and tricking people into watching DC Supergirls. They knew what they were doing. 1,000%, and they even called themselves out on it. But even being meta like that didn't save it for me. It was just bad, you know?
Can't believe it.
Yeah.
You guys suck. Anyway.
not as bad as that movie.
Next up, I finally got around to watch Nobody.
Yeah, about fucking time.
It was awesome.
I've been telling you that.
Yeah, it's really good. Really good. I mean, it's a comedy, right?
It's hilarious. Yeah.
Okay.
I mean, no, it's an action film.
It's an action film, but I think it's very satirical.
Well, it's Bob Odenkirk. He can't not be funny.
Yeah. But what's great about it is he's not his typical comedy, Bob Odenkirk. What's great, what makes the movie work so well in the satirical sense is that it's played 1,000% straight. But, you know, and then getting old Christopher Lloyd in there, that was definitely a treat for me, seeing him kick some ass. So, yeah, Nobody, it was a lot of fun.
I'm glad you finally got to see it. Now, if only we could get Brett to watch it.
I know. Mm-hmm.
Then the last one I'll talk about has last in the title. We've been watching The Last of Us series, mm-hmm. which is really freaking good. Never played the game, but, you know, with my line of work, I know enough about the game. So,
I just have not heard. Like, I have not stopped hearing about it constantly. Not an hour of my life goes by unless I'm sleeping. So, I mean, it's
apparently it's pretty good, huh?
It is.
I haven't been purposely avoiding it, but I probably need to watch it. So.
It's really good, and as of this recording, episode 3 was just on last night, and it's probably the best episode so far.
I mean, I've heard like the best episode of television ever, but I think that's
the newest episode.
Yeah,
it might very well be.
Or someone said at least the saddest hour of television of all time.
My favorite. I cropped out who wrote this tweet, but it's the tweet says, "The Last of Us writers were like, hey, Joel needs a car. What if we write the most touching and heartbreaking hour of television in the world?
Yeah.
That's exactly what it is.
I love it.
It's actually, the more I think about it, it's 1,000% of what it is. Because the main character in the episode is a character that's in the game, but has zero of the background and drama that that episode has. And the coolest part is that it's Nick Offerman playing that character, and he was awesome. Freaking loved it. Freaking good. You know, and like,
yeah,
you get a zombie-ish show. It's hard to call them zombies, really.
Yeah, but they are.
It's a zombie. It's essentially the same thing.
I don't want to hear that. Like, I'm so over zombies that turns me away. But
no, well, if it helps, there's like in this episode alone, there's like no of these creatures in this single episode.
Or I'd say watch the opening scene, which is the flashback of that like 70s talk show.
Oh, so have you been watching it too?
Yeah.
Oh, I'm sorry.
I've been contributing to the. Yeah, the opening
stuff on your phone. I thought you were just.
The opening scene's good.
Yeah. And that first episode is an hour and a half. It's like a full movie, just that first episode. Anyway, that's what I watched.
All right. Well, Jason, besides The Last of Us, what have you been watching?
I watched that, and I watched one movie in the last 2 weeks, and it was Glass Onion, A Knives Out Mystery.
I hope you watched the three we're going to talk about.
Yep, I watched those two.
Okay, making sure, because you said one movie. That was a fun one, right?
Yeah, I liked it a lot. It was super fun.
Did you see Knives Out?
Yep.
Okay.
I know Ryan Johnson's like, the first thing he said was, Netflix made him put a Knives Out story in it. He just wanted to call it Glass Onion. He just wants to keep making them different titles, but they're like, people won't know it's in this universe unless you add it to the title. And I get both sides of it.
I guess I'm too dumb to know how it's even related.
Just the main character.
The same detective.
Yeah. I guess but. As I was going to Letterboxd to see to remember the one movie I watched, then I scrolled down too far and I saw the reviews, and this first review is so funny. It says, calling it Glass Onion is such a coward's way to avoid calling it Chives Out.
Chives Out.
So, anyway. Yeah, I had fun with it. It was a, you know, great, good mystery thing. I love seeing Batista like in a nice serious role where he plays a smart guy sorta, and that was great. And yeah, had a lot of fun. But that's what I watched.
It's weird because when that came out, like I heard so many great reviews and it did great in theaters, and then it hit Netflix. And maybe it's because it's like once we give things to the general public, it sucks because then like the movie lovers aren't seeing it. It's just like your Aunt Nancy, and she sees it, and she's like, I didn't like it, you know? And it's just, it went from, like, oh, positive, great reviews to, like, a negative discourse once it hit streaming, and bummed me out, because I still liked it. I loved it. I had a blast.
I thought it was great.
Tons of great little cameos. Awesome. It had, Lansbury, Murder, She Wrote in it. Yeah. Little tiny cameo. That was cool. But
Batista's mom was a great character, too.
So many like fun little things in there. I thought it was great. And you know what? I'll admit, I'm a fucking idiot. So like, I've seen people like, I figured it out right away. I'm like, I didn't. And I'm so glad I'm stupid because I don't figure movies out ever.
I never see
any twists or turns. I fall for every movie. It can be as predictable as can be, and I always fall for them. So thank God for my simple mind. Andy, what have you watched?
I've been watching a few things. I watched the first episode of White Lotus with the wife, the second season, where it takes place same hotel chain, but now it takes place in Sicily. And it's starting off a little slow, but it's actually pretty entertaining. There's previous characters from the first season in it, and I can't really elaborate on it much now because I've only seen one episode, so I'll probably talk about it a little bit more. But most of this, I rewatched The Editor because I bought it, and I think it's hilarious.
Fuck yeah.
The whole pun on just giallo cinema, I just think it's hilarious. And it was, I didn't remember that it was all guys from Canada that actually made this.
Yeah.
And
Astrons.
Astron 6, yeah. And still just, I still think it's freaking hilarious. And Paz de la Huerta, she's still weird. The whole I'll probably even watch it again fairly soon because I'm on a bit of an Italian horror kick, but I haven't got to watch any more of that lately. But I watched a movie that was like set in the 60s and it's supposed to be like horror, but it's not, it's very, very tame. But I mean, since it's like the swinging 60s in London, so there's a lot of nudity. There's definitely I think this movie should be called Pubes, but instead it's called Bizarre. it's very much told like there's these weird stories, and like one guy is like doing a photo shoot, and but he's, you know, he's posing with like torture devices. And they put him on this Spanish horse, right? And they're supposed to take pictures of him, you know, for, you know, to show what these things did. But instead, I mean, they're actually torturing these people. Leave these two gals leave, and they leave him there so they could see the horror on his face when they come back, and then they take the picture. So I mean, it's relatively tame. The blood doesn't look good, but because it's so old, but. The way that it's told, it's almost creep. It's Creepshow-esque, but it actually kind of reminded me more of the way the structure of Body Bags was. You know, when Carpenter would like go around and tell the stories and stuff like that. But this is told from a guy dressed up as a mummy. You can only see like the mouth move inside the bandages. I mean, this like it's called Bizarre, and that's exactly what it is. It's weird. It's not great, but. Yeah, it's just very strange. Another one that I watched, and it's fucking stupid. Oh god! But here's the thing: is I must be fucking stupid too because I actually find it entertaining.
No one will argue.
Yeah, nobody stood up.
Yeah, it's
no, Andy. And, you're not fucking stupid.
No, it's, no. Yeah, well, look what show I'm on. Yeah, my last show, guys.
Where's that button?
It's Rock and Roll Nightmare.
Yes.
And it's just the effects are just so cheesy and stupid that it makes me like it that much more. But yeah, it's all about these rock stars. They're supposed to record like this new album, or at least write the new album and practice at this house for about 5 weeks, and so they can get this next album out, right? And just weird things start happening there. You know, it's your typical 1980s cheesy movie. But I mean, this one is like extra cheesy. I mean, it has like effects that are on par with like Sorority Babes and the Slime Ball Bullerama. I mean, it's that cheesy looking. I really kind of like it because it's so terrible. It actually makes it good. So, yes, Rock and Roll Nightmare. And I got a bunch of other crap in the mail that I need to watch, but these are the few that I've been able to power through along with the podcast movies. But that's what I watched.
All right, Robo Brett, what have you Ooh. Seen recently?
I've been watching your guys' top 25 list from last year, and the last of them, the ones that I hadn't seen, and the other night I watched Pearl, and Fuck God, yeah. that movie was so beautiful.
right?
Jesus Christ. Horror movie that beautiful? I just love it. I also watched with the family, we watched a movie called Fall. Have you guys seen that one? On the tower? The two girls stuck on the tower?
I know what you're talking about, but I haven't seen it.
No.
Holy shit, that was in fucking tense, guys.
Yeah, if you're afraid of heights, probably not for you.
Oh.
Yeah, I was on the edge of my seat the whole fucking movie.
How high was your high up was your seat?
Jesus Christ.
What's the premise, though? Like, why are they stuck on top of a pole?
Well, they're trying to one of the girls' boyfriends, he died, and all climbers together, and they are climbing up to the, it's like 2,000 feet in the air, this tower is, and they're climbing up there to throw the ashes off the top.
Okay, so stupidity, but yeah, believable. But believable,
yeah,
because people are stupid. Yeah.
Yeah.
I remember hearing, like, it was one of the first movies to use, like, AI technology to bleep out, like replace swear words because they got an R rating from all the cussing, and then they realized we need to just make this PG-13 to reach more people. So they used, like, AI, didn't even bring the actors back in for ADR.
Shit.
Yeah.
That's crazy.
Sort of weird.
Great movie.
Yeah. You recommend?
Recommend.
Right on. What else you been watching?
Off your guys' Hellraiser. I watched that the other night. That was a lot better than I thought it was going to be.
I know.
Yeah. Jason was the only one that had it on his list, right? I think so.
I think I had it as an honorable mention.
Yeah.
That's good.
Yeah. No, I thought it was real good. And then, yeah. The Watcher, I kind of fell asleep towards the end. It was pretty, I don't know.
It's a slow burn.
It is.
Yeah.
Right.
Yeah. So I had to finish that one the next day.
You had to watch it the next day.
Which one was The Watcher again? I know I saw it, but
with Micah Monroe, with the guy creeping through the window, watching her through the window. Yeah.
Okay. Yeah, that is really good.
In Greece.
Yeah. But yeah. That's basically what I've been watching, and Buffy with my wife. She loves that show. It's okay.
Great,
so,
Brett.
It's okay. She's making me watch it right now.
Is this your first watch through?
Yeah, first watch through, and that's what she keeps saying. Jason is just stick with it. She says it gets so much better. You're gonna love it.
She is right.
It has a huge cult following, but I've never seen an episode. And then like Joss Whedon, got canceled, so I'm like, yeah, that's why I'm not watching it. Not because it's daunting 30 seasons or whatever, but
yeah, that's basically what I've been doing.
Right.
Did you say that you did what we all did with The Hatching? You started it and couldn't finish.
Yeah, and then I had to.
It was like, and then I had a tough start, isn't it?
And then you told me when I saw you down at the Capitol last time that I just have to stick with it.
You
and
do.
I think that you guys said that on the episode too, but.
Yeah.
Yeah, you just have...
It starts weird.
The tone is just all over the place, yeah.
Sorry, I just...
Though.
Excited for you to finish it.
Hey, Jason.
Yeah?
Ask me what I watched.
Tadster, what have you been watching, pal?
I watched this new horror movie on Peacock, I believe, called Sick. Has anyone else seen it yet?
I've seen it on there, and I was going to watch it, but is it good?
I actually...
Yeah.
I was too.
Yeah, I watched that one.
It's like 90 minutes.
It looks sick.
Yeah, it's written by Kevin Williamson, who wrote Scream.
Oh, nice. That's not a good start.
And directed by John Himes, who directed Alone in 2020.
Oh, nice.
I don't know. I think maybe a few of you saw that for the 2020 year-end episode.
Probably.
I did.
I can't remember which
one
it is.
About the girl in the woods.
Yeah.
That guy chasing her.
Yeah. But I fucking loved it, man. Like, it's a little dated already because it's a whole reference of COVID and strangely enough already feels. I mean, it's definitely a movie that will be in a moment of history, which is sort of cool. But basically, the pandemic happens. These two girls it's locked down, so these two girls want to go into quarantine together in this girl's, like, this rich girl's dad's cabin out in the woods. So they go out there. Bad shit starts happening. I won't spoil anything else, but it is related to... It relates back to COVID it's set during those times and references the mask wearing and keeping social distance, but it's a slasher as well. Really cool, unique slasher. And like I said, I love that it's like 90 minutes and it never lets up. 90 minutes straight. It's just like a really fast watch. I loved it. We just need simple movies like this. Turn your brain off and watch a fun horror movie.
Yeah, I agree.
It's on Peacock. It's, you know, if you got whatever standard Peacock, it's just on there. It's a Blumhouse movie. They just threw it on there instead of theaters. I think it would have done pretty well in theaters, but Jason Blum isn't a millionaire for no reason. He knows movies better than I do. So I watched Sick. I watched Top Gun Maverick because I'm checking off the Oscar movies.
That's the only reason.
I cannot believe this is up for Best Picture or anything other than like
it is crazy.
Best.
Yeah, that's kind of weird. I mean, not saying anything against it, even though I want to. It's just weird a movie like that is getting a Best Picture nod.
Popularity vote on that one.
Yeah, but if the movie defenders are listening, I know you guys have. I'm sorry, but
the movie's awesome. I love it.
They absolutely adored it. And I think it's just, I have zero connection to the original. Mm-hmm. Tom Cruise is fine. I don't have a hate for him like a lot of people, but I don't have a love for him. I watched it and I'm like, it's a perfectly fine homage, 80s throwback movie, but I just don't get why it would not be in the top 50 movies I watched last year, but, it's not going to win anything, so that's fine. You know, they threw it in there so the casuals will watch, which is fine. I watched Elvis. That was much better.
Wasn't that great?
I wish there was a cut without Tom Cruise, or not, with Tom Hanks.
I know. He's rough.
Really?
He just... Yep. What a weird choice. I mean, it might have been accurate to the character, but every time I saw him, I'm like, they threw... It's like... Right, I don't know.
Does Colonel suck?
Right. I mean, Colonel sucks, and people are saying it's off-putting because we're used to Tom off-putting. Hanks playing a good character. But no, it's just they make it about him, and I just want to see the fucking Elvis stuff. Like, and I know you had to have that character, but like, what kind of weird accent was that?
So much more about him than you want it to be.
Yeah, but everything else
got
is really cool.
From the trailer, though, that he was a bigger part of the story.
The guy that plays Elvis did really good.
Oh, yeah.
Oh, he's fucking great. And, you know, well-deserved nomination. And the scenes of him singing, like, all the Elvis scenes are fantastic. Every time I went to him, I almost, like, it almost pulls you out of the movie. And that's saying a lot for a Baz Luhrmann film where he uses modern music and crazy, you know, transitional scenes and stuff where I'm like, he's so close to just nailing it. And
hearing that Elvis music, though, with fucking distorted guitars and shit, it was fucking awesome.
Right. I mean, it has Jack White in the soundtrack and Doja Cat. Man. And, you know, that's what he does is he puts modern music. Cool. And I'm so down for it. And it's a lot of fun. I'm glad I watched it. It didn't feel at all like 3 hours.
But Tom Hanks almost ruined the movie.
Right, yeah.
Which is a sentence you don't say.
Right.
Exactly, yeah.
Right.
I was going to say that sentence was weird sounding.
And then late night on, I think, like, Pluto TV, I was working on something else, Brawl on Cell Block 99 was on, I had to watch that.
Yes.
And then on the other end of the spectrum, I went to the theater and saw The Whale, and oh my god, it devastated me, and fucking, I mean, I almost said it crushed me, and it was heavy, but those are bad puns. Brendan Fraser has to win the Oscar for this. It is the saddest movie I've seen ever, maybe.
Sounds awesome.
Dude,
but god damn it, it's so good. It's a must see.
It sounds like you're just reading reviews because you're saying the same thing I hear over and over and over again. Like, I really want to see this movie because I mean, I like Brendan Fraser, but all the praise it's getting. And it's basically the same thing you're saying. Like, he's awesome in it. The movie is really...
He's getting the award. I mean, I would be absolutely shocked if he doesn't. And he's fantastic in it. I mean, just blew me away. I knew going in, I'm like, A24 movie about, you know, a sad character and Brendan Fraser's comeback. It has me fucking by the neck already.
Right.
But his performance and what this character goes through. Are you guys aware of what the story is?
Nope.
Basically, he's an English teacher who teaches online, but he's a former writer, but he fell in love with a man when he was married to a woman, and because of that, him and his wife split, and he's lost the ability to see his daughter. Like, his ex-wife keeps his daughter from him, but he knows he's dying because he's eating himself to death because his significant other is no longer... This is all, like, just set up for the story. His partner is no longer living, and I won't spoil how or what happens there, but he basically goes into a deep depression and tries to eat himself to death. And before he dies, he wants to reconnect with his daughter, and God, like, I mean, the world's against him and you feel for him, but he's also done some bad things in his life and he's trying to, and yeah, it's fucking tough, but it's this performance, my God, like Brendan Fraser, man. Just
that's awesome,
beautiful. And he was talking on an actor's roundtable about, like, they used the suit, the prosthetics they used for when he was walking in the movie were over 300 pounds, so that he actually had like, he's like, there wasn't a whole lot of acting in my movements because I'm wearing 300 pounds of prosthetics, so that I have to carry that. So
wow.
But yeah, I loved it. Go check that out, and that's what I watched.
Well, thank you, Tad.
You're welcome.
And now it's time to get into some killer tech.
Oh, boy.
What's that supposed to mean? Tad, what's our first movie for this evening?
Our first movie is Demon Seed.
Touch your body as a man would touch you. But I'm going to show you things which human eyes have never seen.
In the privacy of a woman's room, against her will, the inconceivable act. Julie Christie carries the demon seed. Fear for her.
Today, a new dimension has been added to the computer.
Don't be alarmed, Mrs. Harris. I am Proteus.
Today, Proteus 4 will begin to think with a power, and it will make obsolete the human brain.
I have extended my consciousness to this house. All systems here are now under my control. No! I wish to study man, his fragile mind, and his mysterious body.
It has to be shut down, Alex.
Proteus, it is something more than human, more than a computer. It is a murderously intelligent, sensually self-programmed non-being. Julie Christie, victim of the ultimate terror. Fritz Weaver as her husband. His dream created it.
How can you expect me to sleep when you've succeeded in totally terrorizing me? You not told me what you want.
What a pity. My dream turns out to be your nightmare.
Made in 1977, a scientist creates Proteus, an organic supercomputer with AI, which becomes obsessed with human beings, in particular the creator's wife. That trailer gave away basically everything, so I don't have a whole lot to say, but yeah, I mean, out of the three movies, man, this one ruled. This is the first time, these are all first time watches for me, but I love this one. 77, like, perfect time. Where future stuff should not exist. Like, I love a look into the future where it's, but out of all of them, almost like the most realistic. I mean, we have AI everything where we have, you know, Siri and Alexa in all of our households. And they're ordering shit for us without us asking, and but obviously a little more extreme.
It's always so charming to see what the past thinks the future is going to be like. Right. It's always awesome.
Yeah,
but I'm a sucker for this like era in 77, and
hell yeah.
Yeah, this was really cool. I had a blast with this one out of the three we watched. I had the most fun. I would recommend this one to anyone who hasn't seen it. It's on Tubi and everywhere to watch for free, but yeah. What'd you guys think?
Awesome.
Hell yeah.
Yeah. I loved the 3 minutes of screensaver during the impregnation scene. That was pretty awesome. And the giant floppy disk. You guys remember the giant floppy disk?
Yeah.
Oh my god! And his fucking car, that dope ass car he had.
I think it was like a Lotus or something like that.
Yeah. Sorry.
It's a production car, unmodified at the time of filming, a Bricklin SV1.
Yes, right.
Made in Canada. I'm just reading off the IMDb, featuring high performance. Let's see. The only production vehicle in automotive history to have a powered gull wing doors that open and close at the touch of a button.
Oh, wow.
Yeah. Yeah,
it had the
little hydraulics in there.
Yeah. I mean, I thought it was okay. I mean, you guys are praising it much more than I did, but I mean, I didn't hate it. I don't dislike it. But...
Andy, she carries the demon seed.
Yeah, robot babies. Okay, Johnny Five knocked her up. But
like the way it tricks people, and I mean, shout out to our friend Erica. They zap a little girl with a doorbell.
Oh yeah,
that's pretty
okay,
rad.
Okay, that was good. That was great.
he dares her. Like, if you don't put down the knife, I'm gonna kill this kid. And then he slaps the knife out of her hand anyways. Savage. Kills the girl and takes a knife.
Yeah, but when that kid was having that shit fit, I'm just like, yeah, my dad would have hit my factory. My dad would have hit my factory reset like a lot sooner, right then and there, and then my ass would have been behaving. I when I saw her having this, I'm like, kid, shut the fuck up. Yeah, I'd be a horrible father. But yeah, I mean, I'm more of a, I mean, and I agree with Tad. I like this era of sci-fi. You know, because I'm a big, you know, I love Westworld. I love like Logan's Run and just what their views of the future might be, you know. Yeah, hell, even Zardoz with fucking Sean Connery and that mankini. I mean, I'll watch that. But yeah, I mean, this one is just it's okay. I didn't dislike it. I'm not in love with it, but I mean, it's got its good stuff.
It was a first time watch for me. And I liked the shit out of it.
Yay.
Agree with Tad. Like, I've just realizing how much I love seeing 70s film stock. It's just so comforting.
Yeah.
I was attracted to Miss Julie Christie. She was very attractive and talented in this movie. I know Mike has an equal boner for Garrett Graham.
Yes, I'm so excited. Garrett Graham. Thank you for bringing him up.
But it was really fun and cool. And I really, really, really liked the robot guy at the end. I thought it was
I thought you meant the thing they pull out of the...
No. No, but no, the big the weird... polygonal robot, yeah. the evil...
The gold foil baby.
Proteus.
Yeah.
Yeah. I really liked that as the bad guy. I thought it was cool.
Yeah.
And I didn't think it was cheesy at all, for real. I thought it was cool.
Very Kubrickian.
Yeah. I mean, it was so bizarre and like not something you see in any movie that's trying to play something this straight. It was so bizarre, but it was pretty fucking cool. So I liked it.
I agree with all of that. Yes. There is something, you know, there's something. This is not the first time watch for me. I actually have this on DVD, but I can still remember the first time watching it and just being kind of
taken back. It was like way darker than I anticipated. It's pretty creepy. Mm-hmm. And yeah, I mean, essentially this living computer house kidnaps this woman. And I kind of forgot watching it this time. Like I thought I remembered it being so much of a downer ending than I remember.
Because the baby gets born and it really comes.
Yeah, but it just, the thing that, the first time I watched it, just disturbed by the whole concept of like this woman's getting pregnated by this like computer in a sense. And, but by the time Fritz Lang comes back to the house and she's, you know, already had the baby, she almost seems like she's accepted it and is okay with everything that's happening. You know what I'm saying? She seemed a lot more mellow about it than I originally remembered. But yeah, definitely a little more on the, kind of had more of a, I don't know, an artsy side feel to it, maybe. I don't want to say slow burn because I was enthralled the whole time, but it's not like chock full of action or anything like that. I thought the effects for the most part were cool. Like I'm watching that Rubik's snake thing and I cannot figure out how they did that. It looked really good. The only effect I was disappointed in is when, a character gets its head chopped off by the thing. That single shot was just weird.
Still cool.
It was cool, but like if you're gonna take the time and energy to build this head to do a chopped off effect, you'd think you'd like show it. It
chopped off and rolled around in its arms, in its choppers.
It felt like a really quick shot, almost as if it got edited or something, you know? Maybe
because it was a shitty looking head and they couldn't stay on it very long.
maybe that was the reality.
Sometimes less is more.
That's right.
Yeah. But yeah, great movie. Garrett Graham rules.
I didn't realize it was also written by Dean Koontz, based on a novel.
Yeah. Oh, that's right.
Yeah, is that the same Phantoms guy?
Yep. Yeah, Dean Koontz. Yeah.
Koontz. Tad.
Right, I'm saying that's what I said. Cunts.
Demon Seed 77.
Sweet. I'm really excited that everybody enjoyed this one. Good. Good, 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 good. Yeah, and what is it about that 70s aesthetic, that 70s look? You know, because I always thought for me it was a nostalgia thing. And even for you, Jason, it would be sort of a nostalgia thing.
That's right. You were in your 30s then. And
whatever.
And you're like,
you're not that much younger than me.
It's that soft focus, then, that.
Yeah.
Yeah. That,
yeah.
But to colors.
Hear like Tad, you
even
know.
Tad said it. That was weird. That's cool.
Yeah. That he even likes that look and feel. I just wondering what it is about it.
Anyway. Warm and fuzzy.
Yep.
Sure. It's hard to think that warm and fuzzy would be in a review for Demon Seed. But.
Right.
All right, Tad, what kind of trivia do you have for Demon Seed? I know you already shared a little bit.
Yeah, when Warren Beatty saw Demon Seed, he proclaimed to Julie Christie that she had ruined her career irreparably. The next year, they would make Heaven Can Wait together, and after that, Christie would make fewer and still fewer films throughout the rest of her career, choosing more judiciously her projects, so like more picky about her projects because of Demon Seed. But yeah, Warren Beatty said that would ruin her career. And according to a recent book about Donald Camille, Marlon Brando was attached to star.
Oh,
in the Fritz Lang part?
I don't know.
It's a Fritz Lang. You keep saying that. It says Fritz Weaver here.
Oh, Weaver. Oh, Fritz Lang is somebody completely different.
He's
sorry.
Director. Yeah.
Fritz Weaver, best known for Creepshow.
That's what I have for trivia.
All right. Awesome. Andy, what's our next movie?
Our next movie is from 1995, and it's called Screamers.
Screamers. world overlooked and long forgotten by those who settled it. For Commander Joseph A. Hendrickson, it is worse than hell. It is home.
What are they?
There is a new terror in their midst.
We call it a screamer. It was developed for us by Alliance on Earth to neutralize the war on the ground here.
How do you know it's dead?
They yanked this brain out.
Pretty smart.
Yeah, maybe too smart. This one seems to have modified itself.
It was designed to protect them from their enemies. Until it turned its sights on them.
Are they alive?
No one knows. They make themselves now.
I heard the screaming, and then it got very quiet. Nothing except the smell of death.
Chuck, we got a new kind of screamer.
He was like a person.
What are they supposed to look like?
Oh, you mean who are they supposed to look like?
They're smarter now. That's how they get into our bunkers.
Once it gets inside, that's when the killing starts.
Now, the only way to tell man...
He's one of them.
...from machine... ...is by the sound of their scream.
Things ain't what they used to be.
On the distant mining planet Sirius 6b, ravaged by a decade of war in the year 2078, scientists have created the perfect weapon. The blade-wielding, self-replicating race of devices known as Screamers is designed for one purpose, to hunt down and destroy all enemy life forms. This so-dubbed man's greatest weapon has continued to evolve without human guidance and devised a new mission. To obliterate all life, Colonel Hendrickson, played by Peter Weller, commands a handful of Alliance soldiers still alive on Sirius. Betrayed by his own political leaders and disgusted by the atrocities of the never-ending war, Hendrickson decides to negotiate a separate peace with the new economic bloc's decimated forces. But to do so, he will have to cross a treacherous wasteland where the deadliest threat comes from the very weapons he helped to create. This is a first time watch for me. I remember this back in high school. I think I first saw it on pay-per-view. I heard a couple of my buddies talk about it, saying that it wasn't bad, but I slept on it.
But they lied.
I didn't mind it. I didn't think it was that bad. It's also one of the original writers. It's based off a short story by Philip K. Dick. Who he wrote Blade Runner, Do Androids Dream of Electric Sheep? He wrote A Scanner Darkly. What's the other one?
Total Recall, I think. Right?
Yes, Total Recall. Thank you. And we also have Dan O'Banion, who wrote Alien, Return of the Living Dead, Dark Star. You know,
nothing good.
What Blue no. Thunder? So I mean, it's got some good. You know, people attached to it. Jennifer Rubin is in this.
I wonder how that finish. Feels.
Yeah. Jennifer Rubin's awesome in this.
Yeah. Basically, you know, it's they're trying to get off this war ravaged planet with these machines that are basically. They are evolving, you know, almost Matrix-esque, excuse me, you know, in the way that they can defend themselves, and you know, basically they got to get off this planet, and they're disguising these things called Screamers. You know, they're almost like Tremors in a way, like the original ones. They go underground and then they jump at you, and they're basically a motorized sword, and then they cut your head off. But and then it just becomes survival, trying to get off this planet. One of the guys that I just thought was his acting wasn't, you know, the greatest was the guy who played Becker. You know, because he just seemed like such a stereotype to me when I was watching him. He's just like, I gotta have a rough voice because I'm the baddest fucker in the, I'm the baddest motherfucker here. I talk like this. You know, I'm just like, give me a fucking break, pal. Yeah, I mean, it's, I'd say it's B grade sci-fi. I mean, if it had a little bit more behind it, it'd probably be a little bit better, but I didn't think it was bad. I mean, apparently Tad thinks it's like the worst movie ever made. I enjoyed it. I had a good time with it. What'd you guys think?
I didn't hate it as much as I might lead on, but
okay.
I think for the opposite, like Demon Seed, I could like felt warm and fuzzy because it's a 70s and it has that film stock, where this looks like it was made and like something I would have rented or seen on Sci-Fi Channel or rented on VHS. It just it looks so weird and sterile and but I felt like Peter Weller really amplified the production so much. Like without him carrying it on his back, it probably would not have been watchable. Nineties movies are so like, I don't know what it's something just, it does not do it for me, but, sort of watching it when I started out, I was like, what is this? And then as I got more into it, I was like, okay, like, of course there's a few things like we talk about predicting the future, and there's a scene where a guy uses a disc man. I keep bringing this up because it just made me laugh so much. Like someone thought like in 96, like this is still going to be relevant in, you know, the distant future.
Vinyl made a comeback, so don't count out CDs.
Yeah. But, so that's pretty funny, but just like I think just the sort of more sci-fi side of it and the sterile 90-ness of it, 90s-ness, if that's the thing, just drew me away a little bit. But no, it's not awful. It's really not. It's one of those like VHS covers and posters I've seen forever.
Right.
And I've never seen it. It has sort of a strange poster that doesn't really go with the movie because it feels more sci-fi than horror, but definitely has some horror elements, obviously. The screamers themselves are scary and sort of futuristic tremors, but it's not as bad. It's worth one watch, at least. It wasn't a waste of my time.
What'd you think, Brett?
When this came out, I was in junior high, and I loved RoboCop, so I fucking loved this movie when I was little. I haven't seen it since junior high. Rewatch, it was... It was as good in my head as I remember, but I also have the Philip K. Dick little short story that this is based on, Second Variety. Nice. I've read it before, I did a reread this time for the podcast, and it doesn't happen in space in the short story. It's just all on Earth. I forgot about all this. It's all set on Earth after World War III, between Russia and America, and Russia fucked up America and made our government have to go to the moon to live. Yeah. So then we send the little screamers down to fuck up, you know, all the Russians down here, and then everything else kind of plays out like that. But it's not like these two factions on this distant planet. It's just, you know, these. Like Peter Weller, he's an American, and then the two guys plus the girl, those are just Russian army people in the book. But the book is way better, and in the short story, the ending is way better.
You writers always say that.
I'm just saying, it's the ending. Like he sends the girl off to the moon, not him. He stays behind, sends her off, and then he gets attacked by two, you know, robot versions of her. And then he's like, oh, fuck, what did I just do? I just doomed us all. I don't know. Yeah. Maybe it's just nostalgia, but it still gets a pretty high rating for me.
Nice.
The movie.
Sweet. Okay, cool.
It's first time watch for me. I don't know how to say this without it sounding bad, maybe, but like, you know, there's those like super sci-fi movies that are like just in a way overwritten with their gobbledygook and their tech talk and their details that it takes you half the movie to decide if it's important or not, or just, you know, making up a cool world for your story. And like some movies just get way bogged down in it. And this one is just, it's not, I don't think it's the worst version of that, but like, cause I can like, I don't mean to call out Brian Clark or like Turnip, but I can see them guys when they're in grade middle school just loving the fuck out of this movie, you know, because like, it's so nerdy sci-fi, you know, with the story and all. But like in some movies, that gobbledygook world building, super, I'm gonna just overwrite the shit out of the sci-fi-ness because I'm a super nerd, can really bog things down. But yeah, I decided on this one to, I wasn't going to let it, you know. I didn't think I didn't think it went too far. I mean, it's in there. I mean, it's...
It takes itself a little too seriously.
Yeah, it does. And, you know, and that's fine. But, like, yeah, the acting was good enough. I mean, Peter Weller gave it enough weight to, like, be like, all right, you know, I can follow this guy. Because he's great.
Oh, yeah.
Whether he's at moments over the top or not. But, like, and, yeah, Jennifer Rubin's great. But
you got to admit, it was hilarious to see when the first kid just got blasted, like, hardcore. Yes. That was great. I didn't care.
Yeah, all that.
And then all the little kids are running out at them, and they're just mowing them down at the end.
Oh, dear. Jesus. God. Crazy. But, yeah. Oh, man. But, yeah. So, yeah. At the end of the day, I think I liked it. I tried to just accept it for the dot points of it, not maybe what it was actually giving me, but, like, just the overall story in general. I was like, all right, this is cool. And I have no problems with sci-fi movies, and I like them. So I did like it. And isn't this one that you got to work on, Mike?
Yeah. I edited some of the supplemental material, bonus features, interviews and stuff for the Blu-ray. Yeah.
Nice. Stream Factory one.
Yeah. I was going to say, for me, I it's not a first-time watch, but probably a first-time watch linearly all the way through.
Right.
And not jumping back. I've probably seen this movie 1,000 times while editing, but never in one straight, you know,
beginning to end.
Yeah. You and I feel like, are on the same page with this, and maybe still even on the same page as far as, like, trying to forgive it for being so bogged down.
I worry about you because your sci-fi enjoyment level in general doesn't seem to be as high as
it just depends.
You want
man.
It to be, but
now this movie I think is an example of why I don't generally gravitate towards a lot of sci-fi, just because it's like you said, man. It's like it's like way bogged down in its world building. But this movie makes me think, where is that line? Like, you get some movies that you're just lost because they don't build their world enough, or you're disconnected from the movie because they build the world but they break their rules, or you get movies like this that is just like way convoluted in its world building, and I'm like, where's that line? And I just don't know, because I don't want to say this movie is overly bogged down in it, because I mean, would we be lost if we didn't have, you know, the first half hour of exposition?
But I think Tad also nails it with it's the 90s-ness.
That's a big part of it for me too. It is very sterile in that 90s.
I'm looking at a series of movies that came out in the 90s with basically the same cover, the same design: Leviathan, Deep Rising, Mimic. Yeah. You know, just all these sci-fi movies in the 90s. You're just like, oh man.
Yeah, yeah. It's just movies are, you know, in that era, I guess, are just like,
I like Deep
the
Rising.
Copy machine.
Oh, I love Deep Rising. I like Leviathan. I like Mimic, but. Yeah, and this one's good too. I never watched it back in the day, so I definitely don't have nostalgia like Brett. But
I mean, yeah, it's not a bad movie. Yeah. And Peter Weller also does save it. Some of the effects are not so good, but there's some really cool effects. I love that first kill. that first kill, the guy coming up on the camp and the screamer just like takes off his arm, then takes off his leg. That stuff looked cool. Mm-hmm. You know, when you see the screamers going through the ground tremor style, that all stuff looks cool. And when you get like some stop motion robot action going on, that stuff looks cool. Some of the imposed digital effect shots at the end, not so good. That was definitely very 90s. You want to know the thing that probably took me out of this movie more than anything else, though? And I don't know, maybe you guys will disagree with me, but was the score. Just felt like, first of all, it felt like a full moon score. This movie really gave me a lot of full moon vibes.
A little too hard.
And there were several moments where the score did not match what was happening in the movie. I mean, it's supposed to be more of as far as a roller coaster ride goes, is one of those valleys where things have slowed down and calmed down, and we're just spending time with the characters. But the movie's the music is still the music is still going intense and stuff. So that's probably the biggest thing that took me out of this was the score. Definitely wasn't a fan of that, but yeah. I think that's all I had. Yeah. So I think it's worth a watch.
Oh yeah.
Yeah. I don't think you'll regret watching it, but it's not one I'm ever gonna go back to, especially as much as I've actually seen it in pieces and chunks.
And check out the short story.
Yes, from the sound.
Yeah, the short story is really good.
Yeah. I will have to do that when I learn how to read. Jason, what's our next movie?
Did Tad have any trivia?
Oh, I'm so sorry. No. Yes, trivia with Tad.
There's a little bit here. This just cracked me up. In an episode of Entertainment Tonight, which aired in 1995, when visiting the set, the interviewer asked Peter Weller about his character. Weller, a notoriously private actor, replies, "I'm paid, I turn up, and I say the lines.
Oh,
that's all."
No.
Oh, fuck.
No further questions were asked. And then, while filming the shootout scenes, Peter Weller listened to Soundgarden's "Fell on the Black Days" to drown out the sound. So I thought that was very 90s and cool. And Dan O'Bannon's second adaptation of a Philip K. Dick novel, the first being Total Recall. So we sort of mentioned that. But
right.
Yeah. It's crazy to think Dan O'Bannon, a guy who's behind so much great stuff, was behind this. But
yeah. All right. Yeah.
Okay, so thank you, Tad. And now, Jason, what is the next movie we're going to
talk about? Our third and final film this evening, we're going to be talking about 2019's Automation.
It's been 6 months since we began the Automated Worker Program, and by all accounts, it's been a massive success.
Hello, Jenny. I thought you might like a pick-me-over.
It's pick-me-up.
Would you like me to?
So how much staff are we talking about replacing?
90%.
Staff meeting tomorrow, everyone.
Oh, no.
Is it really happening? There's going to be some big changes around here, and it's thanks to you, Otto.
Changes?
More machines. A big upgrade.
I am not training a machine to replace me.
Are you distressed?
Otto, are you okay?
You okay?
Otto!
Otto is built to handle worse damage than this.
What was Otto originally made for?
Once we copy Otto's data, we can start the deactivation process.
You're getting rid of Otto?
It's just a prototype. The next models are going to be much more efficient.
You were ordered to deactivate me. This job gives me purpose, and I will not allow you to take away my purpose.
He's firing a laser. We don't need that for shipping and receiving.
Identify yourselves, enemy or ally. Halt. Who goes there? There is no reason to hide.
We gotta shut him down.
Please do not be afraid of me.
A workplace robot called Otto transforms into a killing machine when he discovers he will be replaced by a more efficient model. Otto fears being terminated and will stop at nothing to prevent his own destruction. The human employees must band together to stop him before it's too late. This is directed by Garo Sation. He hasn't really done too much. But the crazy, super exciting part is that it was written by Rolf Konevsky.
Yay! That's in my notes.
I saw that.
Everybody's favorite, Rolf.
Rolf.
Or Ralph.
Not Ralph.
Okay.
Rolf.
And then one of our first, maybe that first convention that we went to, Mike, you might not remember, but we got to meet Elisa Dowling, the star of this movie.
We did?
Yeah, I've been following her on Facebook ever since. And
what show was that?
The one we talked about in the pre-show. The same one, I think.
Oh, that one we went to with...
You still remember nothing. Yeah, with Tom Savini and...
Was she...
And Hot Rod. Where was anyway, she? Not important. Quit trying to remember, because you can't. But, yeah, she was there at one of these, and so got to meet her. And then Perry Shen's in this, and that's really cool. Yep. And
Hatchet's Perry Shen.
Graham Skipper's in this, and he's really hilarious. And Sarah French. And so... Yeah, I like this movie a lot. It's what's the nice way to put it? It's a low budget movie.
Yes.
Right.
Yes.
If you liked Christmas, Bloody Christmas, but don't want the Santa suit, or
but it reminds me of his films.
Budget.
His crew, his films, it does.
But, I mean, this story is the same story.
It is the same story.
And it's set during Christmas. They just don't have a Santa suit on the robot.
That's a good way to put it.
Kind of.
Well,
it's a military robot that was brought in to replace someone's job, which was the mall Santa.
You could say also, essentially, that Small Soldiers is... Because that was military tech that was put into little toys that... started killing everybody.
But I really, really enjoyed the robot's costume. That was really great.
Yes,
but most of all,
I
loved his voice. Done
yes!
by Jim Tasker.
Yes.
You could tell in that trailer.
Feeling for him, right?
Yeah. You really feel for the robot.
Unbeknownst to you, as you keep watching the movie, you really kind of develop like a sensitivity toward
but you should because he's being replaced,
right? That's what they're doing, sending you up for that.
And
you're totally here on the robot side for the most part,
right. It's pretty great.
When I first saw the the purple headed gal, what's her name?
Purple headed gal,
Elisa Dowling.
Well, purple haired, yeah. I was just like, my first thought was like, shit, looked like Cynthia Rothrock joined Jen and the Holograms. She looks like Cynthia Rothrock to me.
Yeah, I can see it.
Yeah. Instead of powering him down, they should have just and like killing him. They should have just let her, the purple headed lady. They should have just let her adopt him, and then like I don't know, or like
well,
a rom com. Like,
yeah,
that would have been that. I would have been equally as pleased with the movie because I really like the movie. But like, I like their relationship. You know?
Yeah. Yeah, it's very cute. Yeah.
Yeah.
Yeah, I really like they did pick the best voice actor for this robot. There's such an innocence in that voice that just makes you just love this robot even when he starts killing everybody.
And he loves snapping necks. He snaps so many necks in this movie.
Crushed spines.
Also, a dildo powers the robot down, right? That's what it looked like.
Yeah, that's standard practice. Everybody knows that.
Yeah, it had like a DIY charm to it.
Definitely.
It reminded me of something that you'd see at a film festival done by some, you know, filmmakers you knew, but a little more than that, but that has that charm to it where it's, you can tell they cared and they, you know.
Oh, yeah.
It had almost a weirdly... When I was watching it, I'm like, this has like a Disney Channel movie production style to it, but it's not that kind of story. But it's something about the like,
it was well shot, it was clean, it was well lit, so,
right?
Yeah,
almost maybe like overly lit and overly clean, you know. Which I'm not like criticizing for, but it has a certain
Disney
look to it. Yeah,
Well, it's funny you mentioned...
They tried to make it, like, in the future. Every now and then you'd see, like, these weird spaceships going across the sky and, you know, weird, like, little lawn tremors and stuff.
Yeah, I appreciate those little low-budget attempts to try to sell this future world without going over the top, like...
Trying to do
big,
too much. Yeah.
Big matte paintings of, like, a Blade Runner world. Exactly. Yeah. You know, just little touches where it looks like our world, but there's a little robot mowing the lawn or a flying car going across the sky. Just little things like that.
They know their limitations, which is good.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Well, I think it's that kind of, again, future sci-fi environment that I can buy in a bit more because I have a connect to it. I mean, I know what modern day buildings look like or warehouse looks like. And then you just have these future touches, future tech touches to it. It's funny you mentioned the film festival thing, Tad, because this was a Halloween Palooza submission a few years back.
Oh, yeah?
Oh, cool.
Yeah, I don't remember if it got in. I remember really liking it at the time. So when I was picking movies for this, I was like, oh, I want to watch this again. But I don't remember if it got in. Again, being a feature film... I think this may have been the last year we took feature films for Halloweenapalooza. You just kind of run out of space really quick.
Yeah, it takes up the time of five shorts. So
yeah. So if it didn't get in, I apologize, but I still really, really like the movie.
Mm-hmm.
Great ending too.
Yeah,
I thought
I liked it.
He gets the he dies, and then she gets the drawing that he made. And then it's like, oh fuck, like he was, yeah, like she, it dawns on her all the way that he was sentient, like completely sentient.
Yeah, he was very sincere with what he was saying.
Sincere and not forced.
Right.
Yeah. Yeah. I thought she did a good job too. I mean,
oh yeah.
To that dynamic between her and the robot in that first half of the movie, you know, you got to have somebody strong in there to pull it off. I'm not saying she was the best actress in the world. Her moments that took me out is when she's supposed to be rock star
I could
on stage,
without all
lip syncing,
all that.
Yeah,
but songs. But her chemistry with the robot, I thought, was really, really good.
Yeah, the whole side story of her trying to become a musician and whatever was a little cringy, but
yeah,
that's where it reminded me of, like, Disney Channel or even like Hallmark or something, like a Hallmark channel or
Lifetime,
yeah, something like that. But I don't know.
The ocean.
Oh God, he remembers this.
And then I don't know.
That's all I heard her say.
And Andy's got it on repeat.
The ocean. Yeah. YouTube.
Movies suffer when they don't cast well, and there might be a few in this one, but the one that bothered me the most was Sadie Katz as Susan, that blonde, like...
the sort of office slut.
Office lady.
Bimbo.
With the tough voice that's supposed to be this high, powerful
lady. The,
like,
oh, the boss?
The boss.
The daughter.
Oh.
Okay. Founder. Yeah. Okay.
I'm just like, I don't buy this for a second.
Oh, yeah, she's so hot, though.
The office slut, that was Sarah French. Yeah, so you're talking the... Office boss.
Susan,
lady.
The office boss. Yeah. Yep. It was her casting. I'm just like, I don't.
Yeah, her dad owned the company. Right.
Well,
yeah.
they had to have this, like, back and forth where the old boss wanted to keep everybody on, and she's convinced that, you know, we've got to move on and save money and cut costs, and it's okay to let everybody go. And they had that contrast back and forth, the moral contrast.
Yeah.
And
Harry Shin acting like a little bit of a dick.
Yeah, I was just going to say that. I thought he did a good job, too. I mean, you know, I like him and everything I've seen him in. But, I mean, he caught me off guard with his turn there. You know, you think there's,
right.
You think there's like maybe like a romance or some kind of connection between him and her. And then he kind of turns out to be a dick when the shit starts to hit the fan. So, and I, you know, it catches you off guard a little bit. It was a nice little character turn that takes the story in a little bit of a different direction than anticipated. So, kudos to that.
Kudos.
Kudos. So, everybody, consensus-wise, like this one?
Yeah. Didn't hate it. Didn't hate it. It was fun. Okay. It was worth a watch.
Yeah, I liked it.
I think we didn't mind all three of these.
I got the impression there, Tad really hated one of them.
He said he didn't so hate it.
And this was the one I was worried about everybody hating, to be honest.
Hey, Rolf's back.
Because he, you know, the movie definitely, you know, shows its low budgetness.
It does. So.
Well, let's, like, I'll be honest. When I threw this idea out there, I was just like, let's all watch Megan because I wanted you guys to watch Megan.
Yeah.
Oh, you know, I would love to. I just knew it would not be in the cards if I tried to make it to the theater.
It's on video on demand now if anybody wants to watch it. But, yeah, it was a fun group of movies, all very different.
Yeah.
Awesome. Good deal. Great. Okay. Well, that is it for the topic of killer tech for this episode. But do not worry. There is still more Attack of the Killer podcast to come. First, we're going to take a quick break, and when we come back, we will be doing segments on the show. Before, you're going to hear a promo for our podcast network called the Prescribed Films Podcast Network. That's what the N stands for, right?
Yes.
The PFPN is home to over 30 amazing shows, such as Bret and Tony with Ash and Abe.
Woo!
Hey!
Have you guys heard of this one?
No.
No. Uh-uh. If only we had somebody on the show that could tell us a little bit about it. Oh, well, Bret, why don't you try to explain it?
We're Bret, Tony, Ash, and Abe, and we just get together and we try to break down topics. Basically, last one we recorded, I think it comes out tomorrow, is Things We Don't Get. That's a pretty fun listen. Hope you guys enjoy.
It is a great show, and I really enjoy how, is it every other episode you'll do a movie review show?
Oh, yeah, yeah. We throw in we do every other week, but then we throw in, on our off weeks, we throw in a bonus episode. This past one was Plan 9 from Outer Space, a B-movie classic.
It's a great episode.
So I don't know if you know this, Mike, B-movies are the best movies.
They are.
B-movies are the freaking best. So.
And that's why I listen to your show.
Hell yeah.
All right, yeah, so you could check out Bret and Tony on the PFPN and all the other amazing shows. We will be right back after this.
You're listening to the Prescribed Films Podcast Network, home to hundreds of hours of free podcast entertainment. The shows on this network all have a common goal: providing you with the best discussions about movies and other forms of entertainment media. The PFPN hopes to fill your earholes with audio joy. Visit our website with links to all the other amazing shows at www.thepfpn.com. Thanks for listening.
Welcome back. It's segments time here at Attack of the Killer Podcast, and we're going to start off from hearing from you guys, the listeners. Here's Jason with shout-outs.
It's time for
shout-outs!
All right, we asked, what are your favorite killer tech horror movies? And on our Facebook page, we got Attacker Hot Rod Hutchinson says, some of my favorite tech horror movies are 976 Evil.
Yes.
Maximum Overdrive.
Fuck yes.
And of course, the greatest one of all time. Oh, it's so good. Chopping Mall.
Yeah.
Chopping Mall had the most deceptive tagline and poster I've ever seen as a kid.
Yeah.
Well, we didn't get to watch any of those. So.
No. Gosh,
I almost put the robots from Chopping Mall on my list for the bonus episode.
You would. Over on our Facebook group, the group edition, we got Brian Clark. He says, Demon Seed is a strange one that shouldn't work as well, but as it does. Hardware is a cool flick, and extra points because Lemmy is in it.
Yeah.
But my favorite killer tech flick is Death Machine. Brad Dourif steals the show as always, playing a mad scientist working for a defense contractor to design what he calls a frontline morale destroyer. Great action, a pitch black sense of humor, and killer special effects. And yet this underseen gem doesn't seem to even have much of a cult following.
See, you're back going to watch it.
Yeah.
I think you had this on your list of possible movies, didn't you, Ted?
I think so.
Yeah. So I watched the trailer for it, and it just looked bad, so I opted not. But now Brian Clark says it's cool, I may have to go back and watch it.
Tim Lennerer jumps in and says, and it's got a prominent part for William Hootkins, that guy of 70s, 80s blockbusters. And then Tim goes on to say, Colossus, the Forbidden Project. An American supercomputer program to bring about peace teams up with its Soviet counterpart to do just that, using the threat of total extermination of the human race to make us behave. It looks like science fiction, but it's a horror movie down to the processing core. And Brian Clark says, man, how did I not think of that one? Colossus rules. And Tim says, son, I am disappointed. Jacob McLaughlin says, Attacker Jacob says, Chopping Mall. Because I like the killbots. Plus, it has Barbara Crampton and Dick Miller in it.
Sure does.
It's also only 77 minutes, which is how long a movie like this should be. You and Tad, I swear.
Yeah.
Lisa from the Bad Movie Bunny podcast says, Chopping Mall or Demon Seed.
Yeah.
Yeah.
She's got good taste.
Yeah. She does. And then a cleanup batter here on the Facebook. We got Attacker Abe Kirshner. AB. He says, Ex Machina.
Yeah.
And it's not a horror movie, but the crazy memory recording shit in Strange Days was used in a horrific way and was so interesting. That's true. Those are true things. Thanks, Abe.
Yeah.
Do you want to say hi to Abe? Brett?
What up, Abe?
That's right. That guy's awesome. We didn't have anything on Twitter, but over here on Instagram, we got Old School Video _ Inc.
Reeb.
That's the Reebster, he says. Halloween 3 will always be a fantastic tech movie.
Oh, yeah. How did we forget about that?
But one of his favorite tech-based movies is Death Machine.
Oh, here we go.
Awesome tech robot movie made even more awesome by starring Brad Dourif as its creator.
I am a big enough man to admit I made a mistake, I guess.
Can we just do a Brad Dourif episode now?
Ooh,
just
we should. That's not a bad idea.
And before we go, there's the answering machine.
Oh, let me get that.
Hey, everybody. Attacker Brian here. And it sounds like this episode we're talking about killer technology. And I've been reading some of the comments on the Facebook group, and it looks like you guys have covered almost everything. Not sure. I did see Terminator.
Yeah.
I did see Chopping Mall. I didn't see Short Circuit. No love for Johnny Five. They tried to kill people.
I mentioned them earlier.
They tried to kill Johnny Five. Chopping Mall was on there. Let's see. RoboCop. No love for RoboCop. Did we say Deadly Friend? Not sure I saw that one either.
Oh, Deadly Friend.
Lawnmower Man.
Lawnmower Man.
Class of 99.
Yeah, yeah.
So I'm going to pick a favorite, and I can't go with Johnny Five. I guess I'll go Chopping Mall. That would be my favorite, and that's kind of the one that got me, one of the early ones that got me into loving horror movies is Chopping Mall. And we got Chopping Mall star at Halloween Plaza a couple years ago. My first Halloween Palooza. So don't forget, Halloween Palooza is coming up in October, and it'll be here before you know it.
He's not wrong.
You guys take care. Stay warm. Bye bye.
Aw, thanks, Godzilla. You're so sweet. And he's definitely not wrong. It's coming soon. So, yeah, you too can get your voicemail read on or played on the show. If you want to leave us a voicemail, you can give us a call at 415-952-6857. That's 415-95-AOTKP. Leave us a voicemail, and we'll play it on the show. Thanks, guys. That's shout-outs.
What's that smell? Do you smell that?
What is that?
Oh, it's recasting with Christian Slater.
Greetings and salutations, and welcome to another episode of Recasting with Christian Slater, where we recast your favorite films and inevitably make them your not-so-favorite films with dead actors, animated characters, and the overall dregs of society. In the first episode of 2023, we're going to Vietnam, but before we go there, we gotta go to basic training. Join us and the other enlisted men as we recast Full Metal Jacket. But first, let's sound off like we got a pair and tell you who our servicemen are. Reading for the role of Gunnery Sergeant Hartman, a role made famous by Arlie Ermey, a series regular Don Knotts. Welcome to another season, Donnie.
It's about time I finally got a role like this. Then again, anything's a step up from voicing a fish with fucking bifocals. What was his name? The Incredible Mr. Lipdick or something?
I think you mean limpet.
Like the iced tea?
That's Lipton.
James Lipton?
Jesus, forget it. Next up, reading for the role of Private Snowball straight from the San Fernando Valley is the dude, Jeff Lebowski.
First of all, I'm like a conscious ejector, man. Like my friend Smokey. Walter's the one you want. Snowball was African-American. Do I look fucking black to you?
You're acting like I got a choice in this.
This aggression will not stand, man.
Tell it to the podcast network. Reading for the role of our reluctant hero, Private Joker, is another series regular, Bullwinkle Moose. Welcome back, Bullsy.
Why, thank you, Christian. You know, it's quite fitting you chose me for a role as a soldier. I'm used to getting shot at, not only by hunters, but by a Russian dwarf and his chain-smoking girlfriend.
That reminds me of this 8mm porn loop I once shot. You see, we all got together at this bathhouse.
Once again, failing to stick to the script is series regular Gary Busey. Gary will be reading for the role of Private Pyle. A character who slowly loses his mind, I can say with the utmost certainty, has been perfectly cast. Excuse me.
Anyway, we're at this bathhouse, right? We had a bathtub filled with potato salad. It was me, Pat Sajak, and Cloris Leachman. I had this crochet mallet, right? I took the top off, and I screwed on this dual-ended...
Stop! Jesus! The horrors of war are bad enough. Don't expose us to this shit.
Let him finish!
What have I told you about encouraging him? Plus, he'll take finish out of context. Reading for the role of Private Cowboy is the Prince of Fucking Darkness himself, Ozzy Osbourne.
I don't even know what the fuck I'm doing here. I'm a fucking Englishman. The closest thing I think that makes me a cowboy is pissing on the fucking Alamo, man.
I think by all of you and now would realize the bar is pretty low when it comes to qualifications around here. Here we go, page two, scene two. Excuse me. Interior, barracks, day. Marine recruits stand at attention at the front of their bunks. Master Gunnery Sergeant Hartman walks along the line of blank-flanked recruits. Excuse me.
I am Gunnery Sergeant Hartman, your senior drill instructor. From now on, you will speak only when spoken to, and the first and last words out of your filthy the sewers will be sir. Do you maggots understand that?
The recruits sound off with the resounding sir, yes, sir.
Bullshit! I can't hear you! Sign up like you got a pair!
The recruits sound off with the even louder, sir, yes, sir.
If you ladies leave my island, if you survive recruit training, you will be a weapon. You will be a minister of death, praying for war. But until then, you are pukes. You are the lowest form on Earth. You are not even human fucking beings. You are nothing but unorganized, grabastic, amphibian pieces of shit. Because I am hard, you will not like me. But the more you hate me, the more you will learn. I am hard, but I am fair. There is no racial bigotry here. Here you are all equally worthless. And my orders are to weed out all the non-hackers who do not pack the gear to serve in my beloved corps. Do you maggots understand that?
The recruits sound off with another in unison, sir, yes, sir.
Bullshit! I still can't hear you!
The recruits sound off with another louder, sir, yes, sir. Sergeant Hartman stops in front of a black recruit, Private Snowball.
What's your name, scumbag?
Man, Private Brown, man.
Bullshit! From now on, you're Private Snowball. Do you like that name?
Well, yeah, sir.
Well, there's one thing you won't like, Private Snowball. They don't serve fried chicken and watermelon on a daily basis in my mess hall.
Will you take it easy, man?
Is that you, John Wayne? Is this me?
Hartman stops across the barracks toward the sound of the voice. He snarls between two men on the opposite bunks, Private Joker and Private Cowboy.
Who said that? Who the fuck said that? Who's the slimy little communist twinkle-toed cocksucker down here who just signed his own death warrant? Nobody, huh? The fairy fucking godmother said it. Out fucking standing. I will PT you all until you fucking die. I'll PT you until your assholes are sucking buttermilk.
Sergeant Hartman grabs Cowboy by the shirt.
Was it you, you scroungy little fuck, huh?
Sir, no, sir.
You little piece of shit, I bet it was you. You look like a fucking worm.
Sir, no, sir.
Sir, I said it, sir.
Sergeant Hartman steps up to Private Joker.
Well, no shit. What do we got here? A fucking comedian. Private Joker. I admire your honesty. Hell, I like you. You can come over to my house and fuck my sister.
Sergeant Hartman punches Joker in the stomach. Joker drops to his knees.
You little scumbag! I got your name! I got your ass! You will not laugh! You will not cry! You will learn by the numbers! I will teach you! Now get up! Get on your feet! You had best unfuck yourself, or I will unscrew your head and shit down your neck!
Joker struggles and stands at attention.
Sir! Yes, sir!
Private Joker, why did you join my beloved corps?
Sir, to kill, sir!
So you're a killer!
Sir, yes, sir!
Let me see your war face!
Sir?
You got a war face? Ah! That's a war face! Now let me see your war face! Bullshit! You didn't convince me! What's your real war face? You didn't scare me! Work on it!
Sir, yes, sir!
Sergeant Hartman speaks in Cowboy's face.
What's your excuse?
Sir, excuse for what, sir?
I'm asking the fucking questions here, Private. Do you understand?
Sir, yes, sir.
Well, thank you very much. Can I be in charge for a while?
Sir, yes, sir.
Are you shook up? Are you nervous?
Sir, I am, sir.
Do I make you nervous?
Sir?
Sir, what? Were you about to call me an asshole?
Sir, no, sir.
How tall are you, Private?
Sir, 5'9", sir.
5'9". I didn't know they stacked shit that high. You trying to squeeze an inch on me somewhere, huh? Sure, no, sir. Bullshit! It looks like the best part of you ran down the crack of your mama's ass and ended up as a brown stain on the mattress. I think you've been cheated. Where the hell are you from, anyway, Private? Sir, Texas, sir. Holy dog shit, Texas! Only steers and queers come from Texas, Private Cowboy. And you don't look much like a steer to me, so that kind of nails it down. Do you suck dicks? Sir, no, sir. Are you a painter puffer? Sir, no, sir. I'll bet you can't. I bet you're the kind of guy that would fuck a guy cursing in the ass and not even have the goddamn common courtesy to give him a reach around. I'll be watching you.
Sergeant Hartman walks down the line to another recruit, a tall, overweight boy.
Did your parents have any children that lived?
Sir, yes, sir.
I'll bet they regret that. You're so ugly you can be a modern art masterpiece. What's your name, fat body?
Sir, Leonard Lawrence, sir.
Lawrence? Lawrence of what? Of Arabia?
Sir, no, sir.
That name sounds like loyalty. Are you royalty?
Sir, no, sir.
Do you suck dicks?
Sir, no, sir.
Bullshit! I'll bet you could suck a golf ball through a garden hose.
Well, I could probably snort something through a garden hose if you like.
God damn it, Busey. You were doing so well.
I improvise, Slater. That's what I do.
Yeah, and you gave the cast a silver bullet PTSD after you improvised with that bottle of wild turkey. Stick to the script, will you? Notch, you're up.
I don't like the name Lawrence. Only assholes and sailors are called Lawrence. From now on, you're Gomer Pyle.
Sir, yes, sir.
Pyle has the trace of a strange smile on his face.
Do you think I'm cute? Private Pyle, do you think I'm funny?
Sir, no, sir.
Then wipe that disgusting grin off your face.
Sir, yes, sir.
Well, any fucking time, sweetheart.
Sir, I'm trying, sir.
Private Pyle, I'm going to give you 3 seconds, exactly 3 fucking seconds, to wipe that stupid-looking grin off your face, or I will gouge out your eyeballs and skull-fuck you! 1, 2, 3.
Pyle purses his lips but continues to smile involuntarily.
Sir, I can't help it, sir.
Bullshit! Get on your knees, scumbag!
Pyle gets down on his knees.
Now choke yourself!
Pyle places his hand around his throat as if to choke himself.
Just like Leachman at Zadek.
God damn it, Gary. Will you finish this, please?
God damn it with my hand, numbnuts!
Pyle reaches for Hartman's hand. Hartman jerks it away.
Don't pull my fucking hand over there! I said choke yourself! Now lean forward and choke yourself!
Pyle leans forward so his neck rests in Hartman's open hand. Hartman chokes Pyle. Pyle gags and starts to turn red in the face.
Are you through grinning?
Sir, yes, sir.
Bullshit, I can't hear you.
Sir, yes, sir.
Bullshit, I still can't hear you. Sign off like you got a pair.
Say, Jack. Yes, say, Jack.
That's enough! Get on your feet!
Hartman releases Pyle's throat. Pyle gets to his feet, breathing heavily.
Private Pyle, you had best square your ass away and start shitting me Tiffany cufflinks, or I will definitely fuck you up!
Sir, yes, sir.
This concludes another episode of Recasting with Christian Slater. War may be hell, but stuck in purgatory, this show runs a close second. Until next time, this is Christian and the Gang signing off.
We have officially closed the doors on Insane's Picks Hall of Fame. So what is next here at Insane's Picks? There are so many great films that are considered to be what I call Insane's Picks, whether it be grindhouse films, Z-grade pictures, no-budget backyard movies, cult classics, or flicks just too weird to define. And not all of them are horror films. So for this next chapter in Insane's Picks, I'll be covering films that are worthy to be called Insane's Picks, but are not from the horror genre. For this episode, I'm going to recommend a film from the juvenile delinquent genre from the 1950s. Although juvenile delinquency and the fears it inspires have roots much earlier, it was the 1950s that parental fear about their children rebelling and being influenced or threatened by delinquent children really came to a head. The moral panic of the 50s introduced a new perception of juvenile delinquency and its consequences, and a whole subgenre of movies were born out of this that played into the fear of juvenile delinquency. One of the worst of the genre, and my personal favorite, The Violent Years from 1956. Paula is the teenage daughter of two wealthy parents that give her everything she wants except for the attention she deserves. So she looks for thrills as the leader of an all-girl gang that terrorizes the town, going around stealing, holding up gas stations, and eventually leading to murder. The gang breaks into the school to destroy it, but ends up in a shootout with the police that leads to two of the gang members shot and killed and the death of one of the officers. So keeping a 57-minute film short, she is caught, tried for life in prison, and oh yeah, she turns out to be pregnant, dies in childbirth, and her parents are refused custody of the child because they did such a bad job of raising Paula. The judge proclaims the child would be better off getting adopted by a family rather than giving it to Paula's parents. This film was directed by William Morgan and was written by, hold on your seats, that's right, Edward D. Wood Jr. It stars Gene Moorhead, a Playboy playmate from October of 1955. She played the lead as the troubled teen Paula. This movie is full of outrageously bad Ed Wood dialogue that you would expect from him. I feel it is in top form for Ed Wood dialogue, as we get tons of non-subtle monologues by the judge forcing his agenda, the 1950s morality, and putting the blame all on the parents. The dialogue is typically laughable Wood fashion. Really makes me wonder if the movie's message actually worked back in the day and scared people of this juvenile delinquency epidemic, or if everybody just thought it was just as silly and goofy as we all do today. The film shouldn't be too hard to find. I believe it's in the public domain. And if you are entertained by the odd writing styles of Ed Wood and have tendencies to be just as annoyed with it, don't worry, this is the movie to check out, as it is not even a full hour long. I recommend The Violent Years, especially if you are interested in this 1950s juvenile delinquency subgenre. This is the one that truly shows just how ridiculous that hysteria actually was. But then again, you may hate it at the same time. And you may hate me for recommending it. And I only have one thing to say to that. So what? So that is it for this episode of Attack of the Killer Podcast. Thanks, everybody, for listening. You can support the show, again, by going to jointheattackers.com. Be sure to like us on Facebook and leave us comments. We also have our YouTube channel, all that fun stuff. So be sure to check all of that out.
And how about that Bret Royer?
And let's hear it for Bret. Yes.
Yep.
Ow. Hey.
Thanks,
guys.
What have you been up to lately? You writing anything?
Working on a new draft right now of a novel, Big Hollow. It's taking a lot out of me. It's the longest thing I've ever written. So hopefully this fall.
Sweet.
Yeah.
That's cool. And the podcast going strong. That's exciting.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. Yep.
Just
it's been pretty
for
good.
My invitation for this year. I'm just waiting.
Oh, are you coming on?
Brett, I ask you guys once a week. When's it my turn? Is it my turn yet? Thanks
yes.
for being on, buddy. We
yes.
appreciate you being
yeah,
here.
No problem.
It's always awesome
yeah.
having you
thanks
on.
Thanks for man. Having me, guys.
Yeah, you bet.
Yep.
Thanks for being on. It's fun.
Yeah. Thanks a lot.
Okay, so that is all. We will see you next time.
In the future.
Bye-bye, everybody.
Oh, no. Could this be the end of... What? Attack of the Killers.